Yes, I have a Dutch accent. If you need subtitles, use the button below. During the more than 30 years that I have been studying and teaching the I Ching, I have learned one thing. I Ching users love to read. Most of them, when they consult the book, they throw the coins or use the yarrow stalks, write down the hexagram and immediately grab a copy of their most favorite I Ching version. Then they start to read from the very first to the very last letter of the chapter that should contain the answer to their question or situation. I Ching users love to read. There's nothing wrong with that. After all, the I Ching is a book, and a book that isn't read is just a collection of worthless paper. But many I Ching users expect that the book has to be read to know what the I is trying to tell you. And that is an assumption I would like to challenge. When you use the coins, yarrow stalks, or any other method, what do you get as an answer? Not a piece of text. You get a hexagram. Six lines, either broken or unbroken. Now you might think that this hexagram is just a label, a pointer to the right piece of text in the I Ching. But that view does not do justice to the usage and significance of the hexagrams in early China. That is one of the main subjects I am interested in. How did they do it in the early days of Chinese civilization? How did the ancient Chinese see and use the Book of Changes? If we know that, we might have a clearer picture of the I Ching and its development. And at the same time, we obtain tools that we can use today to make the answers of the I Ching more meaningful. But more about that in a minute. A hexagram is not just a label on the drawer that you can simply open and behold, there are the insights you wanted to receive. Hexagrams and their components have specific meanings that quite early in the history of the I Ching were described, used, debated and expanded. One of the most important components are the eight trigrams. Divide the hexagram in two parts and you have two trigrams. There are eight different trigrams, each with their own meaning and field of associations. Especially these trigrams are fundamental to a proper understanding of the hexagrams, the I Ching itself, and how the chapters of the book are organized. We know that the trigrams have a long record and were already used in the early days of the history of the I Ching. How do we know that? Let me show you. The history of the I Ching is nebulous, and this goes even more for the history of the hexagrams. Just as with the Yi itself, it is not clear when, why, and how they originated. But archaeology has given us a few interesting frameworks which are possibly related to the hexagrams and their development in early China. Over the last 100 years, thousands of oracle bones, either complete or fragmented, are dug up from the soil in different parts of China. Some of these bones contain symbols consisting of an array of numbers, pillars of 3 or 6 digits, although occasionally a combination of 4 digits is also found. The numbers that are used in these arrays range from 4 to 9. It was Zhang Zhenglang who, as Constance Cook calls it, broke the code of these number sets that until that day were called weird graphs. Zhang saw the link between the Shuzigua, the numerical hexagrams, and the hexagrams from the I Ching. What is interesting is that these numerical hexagrams are most often made of either 3 or 6 numbers, which is similar to the number of lines in the hexagrams and trigrams from the I Ching. The usage of the numerical hexagrams did not stop with the oracle bones. We keep finding them on bronze inscriptions, pottery, and in bamboo manuscripts from later periods, altogether covering a period of more than 800 years. On oracle bones and bronzes, the purpose of the numerical hexagrams is not clear, But in the bamboo manuscripts, the shutsugwa are embedded in a clear context. They are the result of divination procedures performed by doctors or mediums that were employed by the aristocracy to cure curses and ailments inflicted by ancestors or other spirits from the netherworld. It is assumed that the numerical hexagrams are formed by several types of yarrow stalk divination. Not only do the bamboo manuscripts provide the context in which the hexagrams were created, they also mark a point in the development of the hexagrams and their composition. In the manuscripts, the hexagrams are very clearly divided into trigrams. The manuscripts do not tell us how a hexagram was read and interpreted, but the division into trigrams undoubtedly had some meaning or significance to the doctor, medium, or the author of the manuscript. We had to wait until 2010 to get a glimpse of a real early divinatory hexagram practice. During that year, the Tsinghua University published volume 4 of the collection of bamboo manuscripts that they purchased in 2008 at the Hong Kong Antiquities Market. Among these manuscripts, dated around 350 BC, was a complete divination manuscript that the researchers named Shufa, Milfoil Instructions. The Shufa manuscript tells us how the numerical hexagrams are divided in trigrams, how these trigrams give meaning to the hexagrams, and how several number sets could be read, combined with elements of the calendar and the Wuxing, the five agents or phases. The Shufa manuscript also contains the earliest known occurrence of the Houtian Bagua trigram circle, although with the trigrams fire and water trading places. With the Shufa manuscript, another document from the same batch was published, the Biagua manuscript that contained a list of the 64 hexagrams. Are the findings that I have mentioned so far unquestionably related to the I Ching? Can we be 100% sure that the numerical hexagrams are precursors of the hexagrams from the Book of Changes? No. For all we know, these findings might be related to other divination works like the Guizhang or the long-lost Lianxian. Professor Liu Xuechin does not even believe that the shutsugwa are made of numbers, but regards the digits as other forms of the yin and yang lines from the I Ching. Nevertheless, there is one feature that the shutsugwa from the bamboo manuscripts share with the earliest excavated versions of the I Ching. They all divide the hexagrams into trigrams. We can see this in the Shanghai Museum manuscript dated around 300 BC, in the fragments of the Fuyang Zhaoyi, in the famous Ma Wang Dui I Ching. Both Fuyang and Ma Wang Dui manuscripts are from around 160 BC, and in the Shuping stone fragments from around 180 AD. All these early versions of the I Ching show hexagrams divided by trigrams. This is what we know so far about the history and usage of hexagrams and trigrams in early China. Trigrams were given a prominent role in the practice of hexagram divination. Trigrams have value. I suggest that we give them a proper place in today's application of the Book of Changes, just as they did in the old days. You can ignore them or neglect them, but by doing so, you refuse to benefit from an essential layer in the Book of Changes and its answers. There you have it, my manifesto, so to speak. The archaeological findings show us the importance of the hexagrams and the trigrams. They also show us that hexagram oracles like the I Ching could be consulted without resorting to a fixed text. If you knew the value of the trigrams, the numbers that were used, and combined it with the Chinese calendar, etc., then you had enough material to use the oracle with confidence. The idea that the Book of Changes can be used without reading the book might be new to you, but it is a practice that existed in early China and still exists today. You might have heard of Meihua Yi Shu, plum blossom numerology. This is a way of using the Yi without reading the text. Or Wen Wang Gua,
another method in which the text of the I Ching hardly has any function. Both these methods focus on the trigrams and the wuxing, the five elements, as the components that give the hexagrams and their answers meaning. Especially the foundation of Wen Wangkwa is quite old. The first principles of this system are already found in the Shufa manuscript from around 350 BC that I mentioned earlier. Using the Yi without reading the Yi is old practice, as we have seen. It is also a practice that has been applied for more than 2,000 years. Why is it that we in the West hardly know anything about it, let alone use it? After all, compared to China, the study of non-textual Yi methods is still in its infancy in the West. We have to thank the missionaries for this. There were roughly two ways of Yi study in China. You had Yi Li, the meaning and principle school, which focused on the text and mainly ignored or even devalued the hexagram. On the other side of the spectrum was Xiang Shu, the image and number school, that saw the hexagram as a Christmas tree that could be turned into everything you wanted it to be without reading the text of the Yi. The textual Yi Li approach was mostly practiced by the Confucians that regarded the Yi as a philosophical book with guidelines for higher moral standards. The Xiang Shu approach, however, with focus on the hexagrams, the calendar and numerology, was the territory of the Taoists who stayed close to the origin of the Yi as an oracle book. They did not see the text of the Book of Changes as a vital part of its application. The missionaries, like James Legge and Richard Wilhelm, worked from the Confucian view on the I Ching. They used the Zhaoyi Zedong edition of the I Ching as their main source, and this is an edition that was compiled by order of the emperor. There is not a single bit of Xiang Shu material in this edition of the Yi. The more than 200 commentaries in this version are all explanations of the judgment and line texts of the Yi. These commentaries might refer to the trigrams, but only to explain why the text says what it says. They are not seen as a part of the answer that the book gave you. The Zhaoyi Zedong edition does not mention any Xiang Shu material, and since Legge and Wilhelm used this edition for their own translation, you will not find any in-depth explanation and usage of the trigrams or other components of Xiang Shu in their translations. Also, Wilhelm's teacher Lao Nai Xuan was married to a descendant of Confucius, which probably also determined the direction of the translation. However, the personal notes that Wilhelm kept while he was working on his translation show that he did have knowledge of some Xiang Shu material, which can be seen with the hexagram arrangement of the eight houses that you find at the end of his translation. The eight houses are one of the most important layers of Wen Wangkwa and are therefore a part of Xiang Shu as well. Richard Kunst says in his highly influential thesis on the I Ching, Legge and Wilhelm meant to capture a slice in time of the intellectual and spiritual development of the China they knew so well, conveying to the Western reader the significance that the great I Ching tradition had for the educated classical scholar of their day. And educated classical scholars were almost always Confucian scholars. Many I Ching translations, and interpretations even more, are founded on the work of Legge and Wilhelm. And because of that, any other more Taoist take on the Yi has never emerged. But times are changing, and there are the last few years a few books published about Xiang Shu and the usage of the hexagrams. By now it will come as no surprise that I love trigrams. I have a trigram ring, I have trigram dice, I even have a trigram fidget spinner. But what do the trigrams mean? That is the subject for the next video. But to give you some idea, and as a teaser, I'll end this video with a summary of some qualities of the trigrams. In the next video, I will show you how you can use the trigrams when you are consulting the I Ching.
The first trigram we are going to look at is the trigram Heaven. It is a trigram that is completely made of yang lines. Yang is strong, yin is soft. Yang is high, yin is low. Yang is immaterial, yin is material. You can't touch yang, but you can touch yin. Because this trigram is completely made of yang lines, all these qualities are qualities of heaven. It has a focus, it leads, it inspires, and is able to set goals. It doesn't necessarily mean that these goals will be achieved. In fact, heaven is not very good at realizing ideas. It lacks the yin part to realize ideas and intentions. It needs other trigrams for that. Without yin, the trigram heaven will be stuck with ideas that it can't fulfill. The counterpart of heaven is the trigram earth. Earth is completely made of yin lines. Yin is able to realize the ideas of heaven. Earth says to heaven, "Give me your seeds and I will make them grow to their potential." Earth does not take initiatives, instead it works with that which comes towards her, which is given to her. It nourishes and feeds without judgment or preferences. This will always lead to result, but the result is decided by what is given to Earth and how Earth is able to nourish it. When nothing is given to Earth, nothing will grow. Earth, being completely yin, is dependent on yang for the seeds that it can bring to maturity. Heaven and Earth are trigrams with either only yang lines or only yin lines. The remaining six trigrams are mixtures of yin and yang. They are the children trigrams, and Heaven and Earth are their parents. The trigram with a single low yang line is Thunder. Thunder is shocking, it indicates a new beginning, it is the alarm that rings in the morning to wake you up. Thunder acts on impulse, with one big sweep, not minding the consequences. It demands sudden change and abolishes the old. Everything that is fast, short and reckless can be characterized by Thunder. Thunder has impact, but it is not impact that will necessarily last. It can be a hype that quickly will be replaced by the next fashionable whim. The counterpart of Thunder is Wind. Where Thunder acts without thinking or concern for consequences, Wind is slow and thoughtful, deliberating every single step consistently and continuously working towards her goal. It never gives up and is not bothered by hindrances. It will simply move around them or take a step back and try again and again. Wind is inquisitive, communicative and focused on exchange. It is erosion that can make a mountain melt away, even though this can take thousands of years. Wind works on the long term, minding every detail. It takes its steps with patience. The next trigram is a trigram that is not always met with enthusiasm. It is the trigram that represents flowing water, the river that is formed by its surrounding, ever flowing down, seeking the ultimate lowest point. It goes deep, really deep. Because rivers in early China were unpredictable causes of adversities, the trigram water became synonymous with danger and uncertainty. You can't rationalize trigram water. It acts according to the flow of its feelings, without trying to comprehend them or questioning the source of these moods and sensations. It goes with the flow, not knowing to where it leads or how the path will be. Enjoy the ride, is what it is trying to say. Even though the flow of water is decided by its environment, it does not let boundaries stop its course. How it will flow is of no concern to water, as long as it is able to go deeper. The opposite of water is, of course, fire. Whereas water flows freely, fire will cling to its source. It will connect and not let go, otherwise it would die out. Fire represents dependencies, but also commitment. Fire gives light. It will show everything as it truly is, without compromise. It is able to build relationships, but also to show the shared common ground that is inherited by these relationships. It reveals what binds and what is binding. It shows the dependencies that lead to attachments, and by doing so, it helps you to understand how your bonds and connections are shaped by them. It protects and shelters what is weak. If you are looking for a trigram that is stubborn, conservative and unmovable, well, here you have it. It is trigram mountain. If you would turn this trigram upside down, you would have trigram thunder. New beginnings, radical change. But mountain is not that. It eschews anything that is new, progressive or otherwise a sign of change. Mountain wants to keep everything as it is. It is the refrigerator that conserves what has to stay reliable and trustworthy. It is introvert and sets boundaries that it will not allow to be crossed. It excels at evaluating what has been, learning from the past and building a solid foundation from which future generations can benefit. The last trigram is the happiest trigram. It is the trigram lake, which represents joy, happiness and a carefree spirit. Don't worry, be happy is her motto. She doesn't care about responsibilities, instead she focuses on what gives her a sense of fulfillment and joy. She represents witches and wizards and does not refrain from unconventional methods if they are needed to make the situation easier, more pleasant and less gloomy. Her optimism motivates you to see opportunities that worrywarts would never see. I like that word, worrywarts, sounds like a name for pessimistic muggles in Harry Potter. Trigram Lake has a sense of creative but also religious inspiration that enjoys and excites, but it risks the chance of losing touch with reality.
That's it for now. I hope you enjoyed this video as much as I had fun making it. If you have questions or suggestions, please put them in the comments below. See you next time. Bye.